Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions about Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. This week we return to the Acteurist Oeuvre-view, Lilli Palmer, The Rake's Progress, and Beware of Pity, a pair of mid-1940s melodramas of differing sorts.
Immediate post-war.
Before we get started, we actually have Leonard Maltin reviews for both of these films. That's a first for the Palmer series, so let's indulge. Maltin discusses The Rake's Progress under the American release title, Notorious Gentleman, and in fact, that was the name on the title card when I saw it on PBS in 1989 or thereabouts. He gives it 3 stars out of a possible 4. Philandering life of irresponsible playboys told with wit and style in this handsome production. He does mention the British title, The Rake's Progress, the director, Sidney Gilliat, and the cast list, Rex Harrison, Lilli Palmer, Godfrey Tyrrell, Griffith Jones, Margaret Johnston, Guy Middleton, and Gene Kent.
So the British title,
The Rake's Progress.
Are you aware of what that refers to?
Hogarth.
So this is an 18th century English artist, William Hogarth, who made a series of 8 paintings called The Rake's Progress, which showed the decline and fall of one Tom Rakewell. I imagine that is a coined name. Fictional character, the spendthrift son and heir of a rich merchant who comes to London, wastes all his money on luxurious living, prostitutes, and gambling, and as a consequence is imprisoned in the Fleet Prison and ultimately Bethlehem Hospital, otherwise known as Bedlam.
Right.
So, committed as insane.
Dissipation.
So this is not quite the progress that we see depicted in this movie.
Well, it's interesting because, like The Life and Death of Colonel Blimp, the title announces a kind of pure satire of a stock figure, and instead we get an immensely complex character study.
True. I found myself, while watching it, well, I had a couple of reactions, both of which left me not knowing how to react to the film. One was Rex Harrison's very, very understated performance, which didn't give me many clues to the satire. The other was that I felt like I had to be missing something, that this had to be a satire of some period or class that I would understand better if I understood British society, British history better. I felt like if there was satire involved, which, like you say, from the title and the subject, you think there's going to be, then I was missing the satire. But then I read the chapter on it in the Launder and Gilliat book we have by Bruce Babington, part of the British Filmmakers series, the enigmatic and ambiguous quality of the film. Like, I was reading it thinking, okay, well, this is British Filmmaker series, it's written by somebody who should know something about England, they're going to explain to me what this satire is, but no.
Well, that chapter does go into the historical periods traversed by the film.
It states, it argues, that lack of explanation for the character and for how the audience is supposed to react to him is seemingly the intended or widespread effect of the film. Even Maltin's tiny little blurb on it seems too concrete for what we actually get.
No, I agree.
I'm not even sure if this character is charming.
I think he is, but he's certainly got his gruff moments.
Yeah, but I mean, Harrison isn't even overtly playing him as a charmer. The performance is so quiet, muted, naturalistic. It doesn't even have that color Babington mentions in a very good few paragraphs on Harrison's screen persona. That color that distinguishes his performances in the movies I'm most familiar with him from, My Fair Lady, Preston Sturges' Unfaithfully Yours, and The Ghost of Mrs. Muir.
We'll definitely talk about historical periods as we go along. I have a decent foundation of knowledge about the 20s and 30s in Britain.
You know what he most reminded me of, but without the noir framework? is Robert Young in They Won't Believe Me, who also attracts women inexplicably as if they're being sucked into a black hole of nihilism or just blankness.
There are a few things operative here. One aspect that is very much within the text, so much of the heavy lifting of charming people for Harrison is being done by his family name.
Right.
That's what the Brazil sequence is all about, right? I mean, he's just there to represent the Kenways, play a good cricket match, and show up to the occasional executive meeting. That's it. Nobody wants him to do anything else, and they're going to consider him a major success if he can just tick all those boxes.
And of course, what's interesting about that sequence is that's exactly why he chooses this job, but ever so briefly, you see some alternative possibility for him.
I love this movie. I liked it a lot when I was a kid, and I've always remembered it. It was the second film that I saw Lilli Palmer in. I saw her first in Body and Soul, and then this one. Now, just to get meta about the two Palmer films this week, there's a lot to link them. I mean, she's very vulnerable in both. Suicide attempts in both.
One succeeds. You can guess which movie if you don't want to go further. Yeah, we get Palmer the victim. Shouldn't we start a little bit at the beginning?
This is a flashback film. We meet some soldiers in Europe in a tank fighting Nazis. Rex Harrison is in charge of one of the tanks. There's another tank in the squadron, or whatever they call tank units. Clearly has some previous friendship with Rex Harrison, or they've become very, very close during the course of the war. I guess it could be either, but they seem to know each other very well when they peek out of their tanks and greet each other. Harrison is like a no-nonsense army man at this point. He tells his friend, "You guys are damaged. You go back. We're gonna do some above and beyond the call of duty reconnaissance on this bridge, which more likely than not has been mined with TNT, but they have to find out. The only way to find out is drive over it and see what happens. If you die, then everyone else can defuse it later, and if you make it, well, great." They start their passage over this perilous structure, and then the film cuts to Margaret Johnston reading about the disappearance of this man, Vivian Kenway, in a newspaper.
So this seems like a kind of suicide as well?
It does, yeah. The film becomes her reminiscences of this man, and she's very ambivalent about him, but also clearly loved him or loves him and is willing to give him the benefit of the doubt on all of the bad things we're going to hear about as we go along. But it's all filtered through her consciousness.
Which, as Babington points out, whatever explanation she offers for him aren't necessarily endorsed by the film.
I think that's exactly right.
Although they're also not sharply contrasted, like you might get with an unreliable narrator.
I think the greatness of this film lies in its incisive critique of this character, which is every bit as sharp as you might get in a pure satire, but it's leavened with this consciousness that loves him, Margaret Johnston, and the two of them together create something that's better than an elegy or a schematic depiction of the descent into madness or dissipation that you might get from someone like this Hogarth fellow.
But why is the question? Why do these filmmakers love this character, these leftist filmmakers?
Because they're humanists as well, and they're not interested in villains. This is a very definitely leftist film. As a Marxist, you're supposed to blame the structure, not people who are born with silver spoons in their mouths and act accordingly. And that's what this movie is really about. We don't want any more of this, but it's not his fault. He's a human being, and there are all kinds of great things about this guy.
None of which are allowed to flourish.
No.
The thing that is amazing about Rex Harrison's performance, or the way he's directed, or both in this movie, is, again, just the opacity, because in none of these sequences does he ever tip you off, ever, as to what is going on with his character. Like, what is going on psychologically with him. There is no tip-off at any point.
And that's true right from the beginning, when he is a child.
Well, that's not Rex Harrison, but yes, it's the character. Why is he wandering into this bar? Where is his father?
When you first see it, you think, okay, well, he's with these soldiers. One of them must be his dad, and for some reason, dad has decided, this is a cause for celebration, I'm going to take my son down to the pub. That's not the case. These guys don't know this kid. They're not likely to ever meet him again because they're from completely different social circles, and that's what the conversation is all about. The Harrison character, Vivian Kenway, he's registered and about to start at Eton Prep School, or public school, which will get him ready for Oxford and a career in politics or leadership of some kind. That's the trajectory his family sees him on. And these Tommy Atkins guys that have won the war, World War I, ask him to remember member of their social class. And they give him this medal that kind of functions like his rosebud. I mean, this is a Citizen Kane style analysis.
Well, no, it's more like an anti-Citizen Kane style analysis.
In the sense that you never get a direct look at his mind.
No, there are a lot more clues to what's going on with Charles Foster Kane, though psychologically and socially.
Right, and there are a lot more people making pronouncements.
Apparently, though, originally all three women were supposed to offer a commentary on him, which would be somewhere between Citizen Kane and A Letter to Three Wives.
Yeah, I think it's so much more interesting and chilling that so many people just disappear from this film. Lilli Palmer's character shows up, is a focus for quite a while in the middle of the film, and then is just gone again. And you never hear what happened to her. This is a film that's very comfortable with those kinds of loose ends and the power that leaving those things dangling has in a narrative.
After these men have, in what seems like one of the more pointedly satirical moments of the film, these men declare Vivian the future. The future is going to be in his hands. He's going to be a part of the ruling class. And then the next time we see him, we go straight from that scene to him being an ass at Oxford and getting himself sent down through his antics.
Structure climbing, flagpole sitting, that kind of thing. He's climbing like medieval clock or something.
The Martyrs Memorial.
Oh, okay.
Memorial to the English Reformation Protestant martyrs.
Wow. That is quite sacrilegious.
And yes, hanging a chamber pot on the top of it. Down below, we see an out-of-work veteran with no pension, acting as organ grinder. So the future promise to these men after the war has not materialized, and Vivian's not doing anything about it.
One of the really interesting things about Babington's chapter, it goes in depth on the excisions from the screenplay. Many things were taken out, and it does seem like very nice judgment was used. And one thing that was in the script originally was that he gives money to this veteran.
Well, giving half a crown to the veteran would have been an insult anyway.
Well, exactly, and I just don't think it works. He's not paying attention to his surroundings.
Not consciously.
No.
But you have the feeling that this, well, because he keeps this pin as a lucky charm that these men have given him through his whole life, you feel like unconsciously this demand they've made upon him to embody the future and lead the way in England to make life better for everyone, that this is haunting him unconsciously.
Right, and you could certainly say it's overdetermined, his failure to progress and become the kind of man that his family wants him to be, or to become the kind of man that those soldiers wanted him to be. The fact is, there was no chance of that. It's impossible. The demand being made upon him.
How is it impossible for him to become the kind of man his family wants him to be? Because we actually, in one of his friends, see a version of that.
Right, but he doesn't want to be that kind of person. And maybe he would have wanted to be the kind of person those soldiers implored him to be. But there's no space for that in the Britain of the 20s and 30s. And that 1931 election that is part of the background of all of those Oxford scenes is pretty interesting historically. I know the movie doesn't go into any great detail about it, so it's kind of lost on viewers that didn't live through that era. But the 20s, that's the decade when Labour supplanted the Liberal Party as the opposition party. Then they actually gained power. And in the late 20s, they were in charge as everything started to go south. The Great Depression hit. The evolving Labour Party crumbled just as quickly. And that 1931 election was basically a single party election. It wound up being a national unity party led by Ramsay MacDonald, who had been the Labour Prime Minister, but he was leading a cabinet and a parliament that was almost entirely Tories, like Kenway's dad. They did not do any of the things that socialists would have wanted to see. Pretty much gave up and said, we're going to adhere to sort of a centrist course and try to keep Britain together through this rough economic period. And so the hopes of Labour seemed stillborn at that point, right? And the film is being made in 1945, when Labour has just won a major victory right after or just as the war is ending, and they will actually start to make good on some of the social democratic reforms that people had been expecting from them for like 20 years. Rex Harrison's character is not growing up in a period where there is a viable Labour Party. Most of the political leaders were from the class that Kenway hails from, the Labour side as well. Maybe could have been different if he wanted to honor that commitment, but nothing's serious is going to be done by anyone during that period. The film seems to be saying, you know, he recognizes that. Like you were saying before, he's not oblivious. He's too conscious of how absurd the whole situation is, and he resolves to go with that flow.
Well, yeah, his options seem to be to either become like this stodgy, boring friend of his.
The character's name is Sandy Duncan.
Little businessman who espouses conservative politics and is a true believer in them, or to just waste his life. Those are his options.
Yeah, and Babington makes a nice distinction there because he talks about the two friends. There's Foggy, who seems totally unconcerned about being a wastrel, even though he obviously grew up in great circumstances as well because he was at Oxford. And Sandy, who doesn't seem to be enjoying himself at all, but he's doing everything that anyone could have expected from him.
Well, his only enjoyment is masochistic.
Right. He actually likens himself to the lead character from Of Human Bondage, which is not a good... If you're feeling that way about yourself, you're in serious trouble.
And that's how he gets rid of his unconscious guilt about the lower classes. He marries them and lets them run roughshod over him.
But yeah, before Harrison gets kicked out of Oxford, he does find the time to romance Sandy's girlfriend.
I don't know if romancing is quite the right word, although they are in a rowboat together.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, she seems to love him anyway, or close to it. He just says, well, don't worry, you've always got Oxford.
I don't know. She doesn't seem, out of the three women, she is the one who doesn't seem like she's in love with him.
She's about as in love with him as she can be. She is depicted as mercenary, but she's got a real yen for him. He can't do anything for her, and she still likes him.
Well, yeah, she wants to have sex with him.
Right.
And we are given to understand that she has other lovers as well, both at this point and afterwards in her marriage.
Harrison gets sent down, goes home, and we see that his dad, Godfrey Tyrrell, is a rock-solid Tory MP, but this character is wonderful as well. I mean, this is in the Colonel Blimp tradition, because they could have easily made him just a ludicrous caricature, and instead they make him this incredible figure of pathos.
He likes his son, and it takes a whole hell of a lot until eventually he reprimands him, but up until that time he is just trying to help him and never even expresses any very sharp disappointment with him.
No, exactly.
And the son in turn likes his father, but they do speak much later during this same crisis point about how they don't actually know each other. They don't understand each other. They have good feeling toward each other and would like to be able to make each other happy, but they don't understand each other and don't know how to do that.
Yeah, it's a real tragedy because you really like both of these people and the warmth is real. I mean, the way they play off each other is beautiful. And they're aided and abetted by the in-laws that provide the arena where that father-son friendship can flourish, because a lot of their bond is forged by trying to circumvent the machinations of the and her husband, Hubert, who is just a big clown. I love that actor. I don't know who he is, but he's also in I See a Dark Stranger. He's great in that, too.
Gary Marsh?
Probably the most important thing that happens, though, upon Vivian's return home is that he meets his father's new secretary, Miss Calthrop.
Played by Margaret Johnson.
She's terrific in this movie. She is our reminiscer.
So she is chewing him out immediately, and frankly, she is speaking to him in a way that she really shouldn't be, as they seem to be contemporaries in age, and she is the employee of his father.
Yeah, she really steps into a maternal role with him, and the mother has died at some point in the past. We don't know exactly when, but she is never depicted on screen. She's referred to briefly.
Well, this is what Babington says. I did not actually notice the maternal qualities of Margaret Johnson, I'm sorry to say, that are so screamingly obvious to him.
Just the way she reprimands Vivian.
A mother wouldn't have to do that. The father isn't reprimanding him.
Well, that's true.
She does approach him as though she is much older than he is, which is weird, because she's not.
No, well, the actress is younger, I'm sure.
Yeah.
And the characters, as you say, probably the same age.
Babington thinks that this, I guess, the emotional, psychological crux of the movie is not an Oedipal complex, but an Oedipal relationship between father and son, by which I assume he means the son's rebellion against the father's values, and that does seem to be true because the son ends up literally killing the father, killing him emotionally by disappointing him to death, and then actually killing him in a car accident.
Drunken car accident.
So I think that's right, but it's a weird, obscure psychology in this movie, which I guess is about the father and the son's relationship, but despite this murderousness, it's expressed by this kind of foggy, distant friendliness with misunderstanding.
Well, see, here's how I see it. Vivian Kenway loves his dad, and why wouldn't he? He's a great laid-back person to be around, but he's angry at him for being a powerful figure and doing nothing to change the circumstances in which Britons live their lives. I do think that that's a big part of it.
It's never expressed.
Never, never, except that you've got this prologue. I mean, we first meet Vivian. He's given this mission by the working class people of Britain to take his place as a leader and do something. And he can see his father's example shows that even a great guy is going to do nothing. Maybe cannot do anything. And I think he, as I was saying earlier, I think Vivian recognizes that it's probably impossible given the situation between the political parties, but that doesn't stop him from feeling frustrated with his father, who's got a safe Tory seat. He could, in theory, do anything he wants, argue for anything in Parliament, and he just sits there and spits platitudes about how Stanley Baldwin is going to show everyone the way to prosperity.
So, with that in mind, we should talk about the South American episode that we were alluding to earlier.
The aunt is the lawgiver in the family. Nothing can be concealed from her for long, even though the father and son try desperately to allow the celebration of his re-election to go ahead. The aunt immediately susses out that Vivian is not there just on a one-day pass. He's there because he is no longer permitted to attend Oxford, and she starts talking about his future and what kind of job he's going to settle into. She mostly is ruling out things based on his
lack of suitedness to do anything.
Exactly. As they're kicking ideas around, Harrison's dad talks about an idyll of his early days when he went to work on a Brazilian coffee plantation for a friend of the family, coffee magnate. And of course, that's dismissed by the aunt as foolishness. Harrison gets up and calls this coffee magnate in the middle of the night.
Thus begins a pattern in the movie where whenever he makes a decisive move in one direction, he seems to immediately turn around and do the opposite. Here, he makes this choice because it seems like this will be an easy job where he can have some fun in a nice setting, and he gets to be a completely useless person.
They want him to be
a completely useless person. And so that's when he perversely turns around and decides he's going to try to be useful.
We've got some great dialogue in his initial tour of the plantation. Working class administrative guy that takes him around is fuming about the way executives are just imported.
He's like Calthrop.
He's actually angry about the state of things. Calthrop is just, well, I work for this nice man, and...
No, but he's just telling Rex Harrison to his face that he can't stand him.
Right. I mean, that is based on class resentment. We go into the laboratory section, and we meet a scientist played by Breffni O'Rourke, who's also in I See a Dark Stranger.
Babington keeps calling him the boffin.
Yeah, this is a scientist who, you know, the way he sees it, his job is to maximize coffee output, and that's what he's doing. He has figured out ways to grow more and more and more coffee on this plantation in his never-ending war with pests and other environmental factors. Harrison takes a liking to this guy.
Yeah, he becomes a new father figure, a new mentor, and these two guys are kind of like his soldier buddies all over again. They become his two best friends at this place.
Harrison even decides, well, I'm gonna take action here. I'm gonna become a project manager or something. I'm gonna present a plan. And he has all these detailed specs.
Right, he decides he's going to help Bromhead out.
Figures, well, here, I'll make an impact in the business world.
All the things he learns here, the lesson that he learns from this escapade in South America at the coffee plantation, could be a political awakening for somebody else, because what he learns in demonstration, not just in theory, is the irrationalism of capitalism.
Well, it is a political awakening, but it's a political awakening to nihilism, right? I mean, which he already had. It's just a reconfirmation of the fact that the people in charge don't want things to go any better than they're going. They're dead set on ensuring that everything continues as it is, basically. And if things threaten to become more plentiful, they are going to burn every bit of surplus product in order to keep that economic course steady. He was briefly threatening to return to a form of idealism, coffee for everyone.
Oh, Dave would love that. The first item in Dave's socialism.
So there's been a spate of firings, and Harrison's favorite people are gone, and this, he just can't take it anymore. He proceeds to get drunk on, like, the only day when he's not really allowed to get drunk. Other than that, he's kind of supposed to, and he's summoned very pointedly to this meeting. And again, this is the only thing he needs to do, is get himself into a chair in front of Sir John and listen to these platitudes about how if they just change their marketing strategy, which has nothing to do with them anyway, all they have to do is sit there and listen and applaud, I guess, at the end, and he'd be fine. He'd be set for life. And maybe if he just shows up on the cricket field a little more so that company honor is upheld.
But this is also something we see about this character. And I think it was very smart of Babington to note that, well, and actually he's taking this from a female critic who wrote the book British Genres, Marsha Landy. The idea that this character is completely motivated by his unconscious drives. He isn't himself aware of why he is doing the things that he's doing, and he's motivated towards self-destruction. So he is acting out of this idealism, or this new disillusionment.
Or camaraderie, at the very least.
However you want to see it. But he's also acting self-destructively, because he cannot, whenever he's set on a course that threatens to give him pleasure, whether it's of a simple or a more elevated kind, he has to destroy it.
The benefit to us is that this is an absolutely hilarious scene. I just love when Sir John keeps wanting to get to the next piece of his oration, and Harrison keeps saying, yeah, what will save this company is we'll sack Brahmy. They keep telling him, we don't want to hear another word about Brahmy. Please let Sir John finish. It's so good. And of course, right after that scene, he's ejected. He's sent down from the Brazil plantation back home to England. And
that's basically his only, and I guess because he learns everything he needs to know about jobs at that place, that's really his only attempt to get a job that would allow him to stay within his social class.
At that point, we find out that he has an inheritance coming to him from a black sheep uncle who made a fortune in diamonds in South Africa, so through untold crimes, no doubt. But yeah, this money is just waiting for him when he turns 25, which is soon, and he tells everyone that he can borrow on it right away. So, Aunt, go ahead and list all the jobs you want. I'm going to get drunk now and womanize. And that is what he proceeds to do throughout the 1930s until he gets to a point where he's starting to run through that inheritance. So he must have really been living it up. And we've got the montage of newspapers to prove it. He becomes a race car driver with his pal Foggy.
He never manages to make any of this look fun.
No.
I mean, there's no attempt to make him look absolutely miserable. Well, until the second half of the movie. But none of this looks like anything enviable or fun.
No.
It looks like ennui and boredom and sort of obligatory tropes of his class. He was reminding me of Rock Hudson at the beginning of Magnificent Obsession.
Of course. But Rock Hudson goes in a different way.
Doesn't he? Because he meets Otto Kruger.
Yeah.
The good father figure. That's really what Vivian needs. He needs Otto Kruger.
A firm, principled, mystical father figure. Well, instead, after various hijinks on the continent, he finds himself in Vienna. The Nazis are now in power. They've taken over because of the Anschluss. There's no Grand Prix happening. Harrison can't win any money, which I guess he was counting on to pay his hotel bill, and now he's actually locked in his hotel, a prisoner. Enter Lilli Palmer at last. It's quite an entrance. Palmer and Harrison were a couple. They were married in real life at this time.
Again, she gets a role that is not the central female role, not the most important female role. But again, she gets a role that obviously draws on her own history, as well as now, as you say, the biographical detail of her marriage, her famous marriage.
And she just comes right in. She's bought him dinner after he's been on bread and water under house arrest in this Nazi hotel.
She pretends to be his stalker, which, I mean, although this is going quite far, I guess it's a commentary on the effect that he has on women.
It's so great. It's so funny, her monologue about how she had gone to see Charles Boyer, saw him in a newsreel, and switched, and has been attending car races all over Europe ever since.
It sounds more like the real-life story of Vivian Leigh seeing Laurence Olivier on stage. It's very nice the way they play together, each trying to outdo each other in understated comedy.
He's just baffled by all of this. When she comes to the real point, it's to offer a proposal of marriage. Her whole act crumbles.
Well, he catches her out on a detail.
He's been planting little red herrings. What it comes down to is is a much more terrifying situation. She is a Jewish woman living in a Vienna that has just gone completely over to Nazism. One of the most poignant things or terrible things about this whole situation is that she represents her father as kind of immensely rich and willing to pay any amount to ensure that she gets away.
And she actually says what happens with her mother. Her mother left early, right? Seeing the situation that was coming. But again, we get another father-only family, which is interesting.
So Harrison, he doesn't like the idea of getting married under any circumstances.
He so much doesn't like the idea of getting married that he nearly lets that outweigh the idea of saving her from the Nazis and also having his debts paid off, because we know he'd like that a lot. And what's interesting is that up to this point of the movie, didn't we skip the whole episode where he once again goes behind his friend's back, this time with his wife? So up to this point in the movie, we have no reason to believe there is enough moral weight in his character for him to want to save a Jewish girl from the Nazis under any circumstances.
But when he looks off that balcony and sees the insane fascist crowd, it does affect him.
This is a different portrayal, though, of the British ruling class than you sometimes get, for example, from Nancy Mitford from this period.
Yeah, well, he's out of sync with those people.
Well, and so is his father later, apparently. Neither of these, they don't seem to be themselves aristocracy.
I think they're gentry.
Yeah, so they're not part of the aristocracy, but I'm sure a lot of the business class also embraced, like, the idea of the Nazis.
Of course, or at least wanted to preserve the peace. I mean, that's where appeasement came from, right? I mean, it wasn't a big enough deal to fight over the growth of fascism.
Yeah, we just saw a commentary on this in Thunder Rock, in our last Lilli Palmer episode.
We did indeed.
So here we get, and I'm just spinning this analysis as we talk, it's not something I thought of before, but here we get the reverse of the South American situation, where he has a noble impulse that blossoms into something more like love than we've seen from him before, and even a desire, seemingly, although mixed up with shenanigans, about wanting to earn some money through betting, but even perhaps some kind of desire for domesticity, because he continues with the marriage after they leave Vienna. Having made this move in the direction of decency, he again has to double back self-destructively.
He has to keep the accounts, as you say, balanced. So he looks out, sees these Nazis massing, and he's like, no, I have to save this person. We have to get married, but I'm going to have to get something out of it so that I feel like I'm not just being a noble person, because I don't want to see myself as that.
But he already is getting his debts paid.
Yeah, but he has to get even more. So he makes up a bunch of debts, throws that onto his side of the scale, and Lilli Palmer's like, okay, fine, you owe £3,000 to a man in England, we can do that. When we get to England, we find out that the person that he said he owed the money to is good old Foggy. He did owe him £1,000, and then the other two are for him. That's his cream that he's skimming off the top. And through a series of mishaps, Lilli Palmer overhears this. She comes back into the hotel room and now knows that he has betrayed her this way. It's all so nicely balanced, and there's so much built into these little betrayals and little schemes of his. He does not want to take the last penny of this girl and her father, who's gonna die in Vienna. He thinks that they're a never-ending fount of money, so if he gets another £3,000 from them, that's fine. That's like taking a little bit from the rich to feed his layaboutism. But what she tells him is, well, actually, it's a good thing you only asked for $3,000, because that's absolutely all we have. We're cleaned out completely. And that is a shocking blow all around. It's devastating for her to find out that this is what he's up to. It's devastating for him to realize that, yeah, he meant to rob her, but not in a way that would really hurt. And now he knows that he has.
Yeah, and then he just sets out to destroy the marriage. It's not some kind of noble scheme, although it almost is, because he does articulate his intention to Calthrop.
He says, I have no intention of being her fate, like, yeah, a melodramatic fate.
So there's some self-awareness here, but mainly it's just a completely unconscious impulse to destroy the marriage, destroy himself, and to some degree, out of his fear that he cannot, even if he tried, be a good husband to set this girl free from the marriage and from her love for him, but that backfires because he is just so damned. He awakens an answering self-destructiveness in the women who are almost acting out his own suicidal impulses for him.
Yeah, that's a good reading, and it just acquires so much more real-world concreteness because we know that the real Rex Harrison, well married to Lilli Palmer, did drive at least Carol Landis to suicide and probably some other people too.
Well, there was another woman who supposedly, a one-time wife, who supposedly committed suicide in relation to him. Well, did commit suicide, supposedly, in relation to him.
Very dangerous to get mixed up with sexy Rexy.
Although you always ask yourself in these situations where a man has more than one suicidal woman in his life, like Ted Hughes, are they creating this or are they attracted to it? But in this movie, it is definitely his creation, the character's creation.
And just to stay with that point for a second, even though it's not directly material to this film or to anything we're talking about, but I think it's a fascinating inversion of the real Lilli Palmer, that she's playing these suicidal characters in these two films, because no one has ever been less suicidal seeming than the actual woman, Lilli Palmer.
Well, she knew what she was about with him. Although he was married to, I think, wife number 5 at the time of his death, he did, I guess, arrange for half of his ashes to be distributed on the grave of Lilli Palmer, wife number 2.
Yeah.
I don't know how wife number 5 felt about that. Wikipedia doesn't say.
Yeah, there's some really interesting echoes of Beware of Pity, too, in his later life, because he winds up marrying a woman who's been diagnosed with a terminal illness. They don't tell her about it. He marries her because she's so in love with him and talks to Lilli Palmer on the phone every day about how he can't handle it. He doesn't think he can continue to be a good husband. And she talks him through it and says, this is your one chance to...
You redeem all your rakishness.
Their friendship continued after their marriage fell apart. The Lilli Palmer autobiography is really quite fascinating. I do recommend it to all. Harrison, she gives us almost as multifarious a portrait of Rex Harrison as this movie does, and she's stuck dealing with life, and this movie is art.
Well, clearly he was dealing with a lot of compulsions, because seemingly he regarded Lilli Palmer as his soulmate, but that did not stop him.
Couldn't stop.
From his seductions.
The real Rex Harrison, I think, did enjoy himself quite often, and that's different from Vivian Kenway. As you say, he is almost monkishly devoted to his aimless pursuits. You could almost call it a Buddhist sense of negating all serious emotions, the call of all serious emotion or all serious enjoyment of the senses. I mean, he's not getting anything out of anything he's doing, and that seems to be how he wants it.
Well, yeah, he's got an incredible sense of detachment, that's for sure. That's something that this performance is conveying. But what the hell is going on with Calthrop? Because she says she's as much to blame as he is for this, but this is a complete act of nihilism for her, because she knows exactly what this guy is all about, and elects to have an affair with him while his very vulnerable wife is right there. She's acting just as nihilistically as he is.
Well, she can't help herself. She just is in love with him.
But again, that is to be in love with nihilism, because she knows who he is better than anybody. He is attracted to the abyss.
But when things get real and he kisses her, she's like, okay, no, we really cannot do this. And Babington does talk about how she sort of projects a part of herself onto the sweet, vulnerable Lilli Palmer character, Ricky, which I think is probably true. But on the other hand, Ricky really is that vulnerable.
Well, under her circumstances, but also you get a sense of how, just as the absurdity of capitalism drives him a little insane, his completely senseless behavior, his self-contradictions, his death drive, drive Ricky insane. Like when she's babbling in her post-suicidal monologue, she says, and we agree with her because we've just seen this happen. We've just seen him do this.
Yep.
For no reason. She's like, I couldn't conceive that he could want to marry me, want to live with me just to amuse himself. I had to believe that there was some feeling and some meaning in that, but there was nothing. There was just this insanity, right? It would drive you insane. His behavior figure doesn't make any sense.
You could see why Lilli Palmer, even though she's a pretty big star at this point, was happy to take this role. It's second billed, but she doesn't have a lot of screen time, but she makes the most of it. These scenes are great. And after this meltdown, everyone has to face the facts, and this is when, as you say, Godfrey Tyrrell, the father, at long last expresses his dissatisfaction to Vivian.
That's enough out of you.
We're all gonna have to go into town. Cornwall is not the place for a discussion of this kind. Rex Harrison does the most nihilistic thing ever and gets completely hammered.
Tries to kill them all, but only succeeds in killing his father.
It's so crazy. The movie sells it. It all feels like this is happening and you are part of it and you are stuck watching this and you feel awful for everybody. The parting scene between father and son, something that Babington's essay calls attention to, and apparently it was a favorite of Sidney Gilliat, the director, as well. The father just has this one line, "You've hurt your hand," and then he dies. And it is really affecting.
It seems like, okay, but on a first viewing, you feel, as Babington says, that this is an example of the father's selflessness. Like, what a thing to say to your son who just killed you. But it also seems like an acknowledgement, this regression to the son's childhood where he has a minor injury, an acknowledgement that there is something wrong with you, and I have not been the father I should have been who can fix it. He acknowledges his own role in the creation of this son who has killed him.
Yeah, I agree. That's gotta be part of the mix there, and that's why, again, it feels so powerful. It's laden with so much emotion and grief and sense of responsibility.
But it's very oblique.
Yeah, just like the whole film. After that, we never hear from Ricky again. She does survive the crash.
She's looking for her husband.
Harrison just walks out, never sees her again.
But at this point, like Robert Young at the end of They Won't Believe Me, he does do the melodrama thing where he's just like, I am poison. I am not getting involved with anyone else ever again.
He becomes a salesman. He becomes a gigolo. I mean, he really descends into awfulness.
And parodies of his charming persona as Babington.
Babington talks about Noel Coward saying,
the greatest light comedian, other than myself.
Right.
But if he hadn't been that, he would have been a used car salesman.
Yeah, he's basically consigned himself to this. He doesn't seem to have any plan for getting out of it. He's just going to wallow. There's no danger of him enjoying any of this, so it's probably quite to his liking, in a way. But Margaret Johnston shows up and pulls him out of all of it, takes him off to the cottage again, like Betty Davis in Dangerous, sobers him up, tries to restore his will to live.
But if she thinks that she's gonna be able to fix this man up and make him into husband material, she's crazy.
Events conspire to show her that this was never going to happen, although she comes quite close and he does ask her to marry him.
I guess she is the one who gets him into good enough shape to commit suicide in a noble way, I guess?
Well, absolutely. If he had stayed in gigolo mode, I don't think the army would have taken him.
I'll just make myself into cannon fodder.
Certainly part of the finale here, when we exit the flashback and return to present day 1944 Europe, we see if there was any doubt about, you know, if he's just missing, if he's going to show up at the end and continue his adventures. No, his tank was blown up and flipped over. He lived long enough to say goodbye to Foggy, and that's about it. Valedictory, Margaret Johnston.
A man who wanted to take risks in an age that didn't want risks. Does that make any sense to you? Or live dangerously? She says something like that.
Yeah, live dangerously. It's a valid gloss on what we've seen. But I do think that the movie is asking us to interrogate that a little further and maybe come up with something like what we have come up with, which is that the only risk he didn't want to take was the risk of being happy. Let's turn our attention now to Beware of Pity from 1946. Leonard Maltin gives this 2.5 stars out of 4. Maudlin but effective yarn of crippled young woman who finds romance and meaning to life. Director Maurice Elvey.
I don't think that's the greatest description of this movie.
Not very good, Leonard. The cast list: Lilli Palmer, Albert Leven, Cedric Hardwick, Gladys Cooper.
This was a real depressing pair of films.
But very powerful, I think. I really liked Beware of Pity. I wasn't sure what to expect.
I read the plot summary of the novel.
By Stefan Zweig.
Yeah, A Letter from an Unknown Woman. Right up until almost the very end of the movie. Right up until the very end of the movie, actually. I thought they had changed the ending of the novel. I didn't think they were going to have her commit suicide. That was a real blow.
Yeah.
That real unexpected blow. That is not the Hollywood norm of movie ending for this period.
No, it wasn't. Like you, I assumed...
They Won't Believe Me does end in someone committing suicide.
Yeah, but someone who is a morally compromised figure.
Yes.
It's a little different here. I did expect for this extended flashback to end with our protagonist. The story unfolds as a memoir of events leading up to the beginning of the previous World War. We're at the end of World War II. Albert Leven is a middle-aged man, and he takes a soldier aside and tells him...
Well, this soldier is facing a dilemma.
Right, and he says, you know, I've got something similar to tell you about. The framing sequence, it's only a few minutes. Of course, I was thinking at the end, Lilli Palmer would walk in, or... wheel herself in or something, and there would be this lifelong romance that we would hear about, that it, you know, it came off perfectly, and this greater pity, this compassion that Albert Leven talked about had flourished into this magnificent love that everyone would take heart from.
No.
And learn from the example of these two people.
No, and the lesson learned by the young soldier, if any, at the end is you'd better find it within your heart to have this compassion, or the girl that you've been pitying is going to commit suicide, and you'll be haunted by guilt forever.
Right.
So Stefan Zweig, I think we've mentioned this before when we've done movies based on his work, which is usually A Letter from an Unknown Woman.
Been adapted a few times.
Well, we've seen it also as Only Yesterday in our Margaret Sullivan series, but worth mentioning again in this context that he and his wife, well, he was Jewish, he and his wife had to leave Austria, obviously, and they ended up, well, a different wife ended up later committing suicide with him in 1942 in exile because they were disturbed by the direction in which Europe was going, wanted to go out on the high note of remembering a time when culture and intellectual endeavor were, and freedom were the highest forms of human life, because they thought that all of these things were going to be very sparse in the future.
Wow.
So the suicide impulses are for real.
They're strong in Stefan Zweig.
Yeah. And actually that's spoilers for Letter from an Unknown Woman, but that's how Letter from an Unknown Woman also ends.
Yeah, yeah.
With the male protagonist taking that route.
Of course, there he's going to be shot in a duel. It's a little different when...
Yeah, but he was going to run away, and instead he decides to go and get himself shot.
Yeah, against a crack shot. Yeah.
After he realizes what a worthless human he is.
Things start out in a light comedy vein in a way. We've got Albert Leven, the narrator. I know this guy best from Life and Death of Colonel Blimp. He's got a great little role as the commanding officer or a higher up officer in the German regiment who takes part in setting up the duel between Theo Kretschmar Schuldorf and Colonel Blimp. We also saw him in our last Lilli Palmer episode because he played the Russian cartoonist.
Ah, right. Very different role.
English Without Tears.
Oh, by the way, I completely forgot to mention when we were talking about Rex Harrison that his breakthrough stage role was Terence Rattigan's French Without Tears. It's a small world of British film and stage.
Some nice little connection. I thought Albert Leven was amazing in this movie.
Yeah, we'll talk about his performance. It should be said, this was... So we're seeing here Lilli Palmer in her first starring role, although she's not the protagonist, she's definitely the star.
Oh yeah, this is the prima donna role in the film, for sure.
Right. So we're seeing her for the first time as the star of a picture. It was not a success. Huge flop.
Well, it's a pretty grim little tale, isn't it?
And the critics hated it. Bosley Crowther hated it, although he did like her performance. I think Radio Times, though, quoted in the Wikipedia entry on this film, was onto something without realizing it. When it wrote, having learned his trade in the silent era, director Maurice Elvey can't resist overplaying the melodrama. Although it goes on to say that the cast, particularly Dr. Cedric Hardwick and his blind wife Gladys Cooper, keeps things on track. But it is a stylized film, and it is in a constant state of hysteria. And the greatest node of hysteria is Lilli Palmer's performance, her manic performance, which draws on the simultaneously sympathetic and unpleasant, like, mixture that we've seen her do before in The Gentle Sex and to some degree in Thunder Rock, that she can bring this mixture, like a character who is sympathetic but at the same time deeply unpleasant. And this movie has a lot of class detail that particularly throws a bad light on this character, who's nevertheless, you know, it's more like Bette Davis's manic performance in Dark Victory, who's nevertheless very sympathetic, but she doesn't have a sort of redemption arc the way that Bette Davis does.
No, I mean, that is the closest comparison, I think. You've got to call this...
The Viennese Dark Victory?
No, I would call it Dark Defeat. I mean, what else can you call it? It really left me feeling like I had dropped into a bottomless pit. But that's the mark of a successful work of art.
Stefan Zweig really managed to communicate his dark view of the future of humanity in the form of a Jamesian woman's picture. Why does this castle have a suicide gate anyway? What is that gate for?
Probably for emptying ashes or
what? You could just lean over the fence to do that. You don't need to open the gate.
Maybe not. But it certainly is not there for someone who can't walk to get through the railings. I'm sure that's not the intention.
Absolutely. What that gate is for, it's a suicide gate.
As you say, there is this very interesting, very concrete class detail of the last moments before the beginning of World War I. We're in the Habsburg Empire meeting these soldiers. Just like in the Russian army, the officers were basically aristocrats and would look down on everyone except for the Tsar. It's the same amongst these guys. Now, Albert Levin tells us, or he tells his interlocutor in the framing sequence, that he was always a little more democratic than his fellow officers. But yeah, they see a guy who is unbelievably wealthy and owns this castle that overlooks their military encampment, and they think he's dirt because he doesn't have aristocratic lineage.
Right, as they say.
You know, that is a huge part of the mental block that Albert Levin has about this whole thing. He can't allow himself to fall in love with this woman, and even more so, he can't allow himself to become a bought husband of a lower class parvenu. Obviously, they have a lot more money than him, but prestige they do not have. It's so fascinating that Lilli Palmer's dad is played by Dr. Pretorius from The Bride of Frankenstein.
This castle in which this hysterical melodrama is going on all the time, and there's class issues or power issues within the household too, particularly this cousin?
The cousin who has been, she's basically an indentured servant.
Yeah.
She can't leave and get married and begin her own life unless Lilli Palmer manages to walk and live on her own.
So this household that has all of these crazy dynamics and all of this hysteria going on in it all of the time, that he enters and leaves and we enter and leave with him, it takes on the character, you know, it's a castle. It takes on the character of a gothic castle,
it's right? Like the weird house in Celine and Julie.
Sure, or even like the family in The Old Dark House.
Yeah, well, there you've got Ernest Thesiger again in The Old Dark House. So there may be intentional resonances. I don't know.
As I started contemplating that, watching the movie, I started thinking about the faint resemblance in their relationship to each other and his particular kind of resentment of it, although without these weird aristocratic versus new money class dynamics, William Holden and Gloria Swanson in Sunset Boulevard. There's a kind of sick pity and weird companionate relationship that develops in that movie and that strange gothic house she lives in, dwelling on her past.
Yeah, you're right. Could even see this version of Lilli Palmer deciding to shoot Albert Levin in some circumstances.
Oh, absolutely. But also, and his struggle of just the absolute impossibility in his mind of ever loving this woman, that's partly because, well, in this movie, because she's disabled, and Sunset Boulevard because she's old or older, but also because he would be a kept man in both cases.
I don't think it's because she's disabled. I don't think that's part of his calculus, really. I think it's really all about the social imbalance there. The fact that she's got money and he's got prestige.
But the pity talk is all about her disability, and that becomes a huge theme in the movie, right?
Yeah, of course. But that's not the reason why he's convinced that he could never have loved her in any possible universe.
You don't think?
Well, I don't think so.
Because that seems to me to be a huge part of his struggle, particularly when he's talking it over with Gladys Cooper toward the end, and comparison is made with her relationship with her doctor husband.
The contributions of Cedric Hardwicke and Gladys Cooper are magnificent in this movie.
Don't underestimate how repulsive the idea, like, it's not something you see in Hollywood movies at the time or now, just a disabled old person married to an able-bodied person or in a romantic relationship with him, don't underestimate the repulsion and dehumanization that would involve. Unless it's Betty Davis and she's going to try to kill you with her mind. Thinking of the little foxes.
Sometimes you get, you know, a mad woman in the attic situation from Jane Eyre and Derivatives. You certainly get that's in Hollywood. That's no good. No, of course. That's not good at all. Just as likely, you're going to get romance where the fact that the person is sick or disabled in some way becomes part of the attraction, like Camille. No?
Well, she's not disabled.
She's dying.
She's got a little cough. She's got a little...
She's dying.
Little tuberculosis. Yeah, but it's not exactly visible until the ending. The only movie I can think of where disability is an attraction is High Sierra, which we just mentioned recently on the podcast, right?
Because it Joan Leslie
contributes to the saintliness of this girl that Humphrey Bogart's character falls for, and he discovers she's not quite so saintly.
Right, his perception of saintliness is wide of the mark. The introduction of Lilli Palmer in this movie is incredible. So Albert Leven, against his better judgment, or against the better judgment of his regiment anyway, agrees to attend this party at this castle. There's real tension and animosity between the officers in the Habsburg army and the whole town. So the rest of them just play cards in barracks. They don't go anywhere. Albert Leven, he's going to accept this invitation. And when he goes, I mean, he's chummy with everybody. He's just a really amiable fellow. He sees Lilli Palmer sitting off to the side. Everyone else is dancing. Gets his mind going. He wants to know more. He walks right up to her and asks her to dance. She tries to get up.
She later says that she just loved dancing so much that I guess for a moment, being asked to dance by this handsome officer, she forgets that she is disabled.
Or she again falls prey to this magical thinking that, okay, this is the prince that is going to recall me to my full existence. But it doesn't work here, and it doesn't work in any of the other cases where she starts to believe that.
The many, many attempts.
But here, you know, it just takes us by surprise. I mean, you kind of get a sense that maybe this woman can't really get up, but I didn't count on the scene being this intense. She just is so angry, and she's crying, and her face is just, she's trying so hard to get up, and falls over. And it's psychotic enough that it's really a believable response of Albert Leven that he runs away from this castle like he's seen a monster.
But also, and the cousin runs up and finds out what happens, and she's like, "You asked her to dance?"
Yeah.
Like he just tried to murder her.
Yeah.
There's this weird, and Stefan Zweig was a fan of Freud. There's this weird, sweaty night he spends awake. It's like he has this morbid fear, and this is the thing that keeps him chained to her and keeps him going back, even though he keeps digging himself in deeper and deeper while being convinced that he could never love her, even though she looks like Lilli Palmer.
Yeah.
There's this terror on his part of hurting her that almost seems like it's concealing some kind of sadistic impulse to hurt her. And he keeps doing it over and over again, right? Until he really doesn't.
Yeah.
What you do get in Hollywood movies, and you keep thinking that this movie is going to turn into that, is something like the whole plot, weird, weird plot with the doctor, too. Like the Alan Ladd and Loretta Young movie, And Now Tomorrow, where there is a woman suffering from a debilitating illness, and she's going to be a beautiful, glamorous woman, and she's going to be cured by the end of it, right? You keep thinking that we're going to get that kind of movie. And right up until the end, it could have been that kind of movie.
Yeah, and Cedric Hardwick, he's making her go through her paces every day, do exercises.
But in that kind of movie, you don't get this repulsion, this absolute conviction on his part that he could never love her, right?
Well, no. No, Alan Ladd's in love with Loretta Young immediately.
Yeah,
even
exactly.
Even though he's rude to her, again, because of class dynamics.
Or George Brent in Dark Victory falls in love with Betty Davis, which is mingled with pity, but it's a pity that's compatible with love. But she's worried that it's only pity.
The puss in the corner scene is basically Lilli Palmer stuck in that mode the whole movie.
Yeah, but illness, I think illness has a glamour, especially kind of abstract illnesses that don't have any physical effects on the women other than to make them look pale and interesting. Has a glamour in movies that Disability does not. Disability is more like deformity. This is more like the Enchanted Cottage territory.
So after he runs away in terror, we get the first of Lilli Palmer's deeply felt apologies for her behavior, and she asks him to come back to receive the apology, and they strike up a friendship. But again, it really does feel like that problematic trope of contemporary discourse, the friend zone. This is what's happening to her. They're having a good time, it seems like. They're playing cards. She's beating him at chess. She's beating him at almost everything. He seems to be liking it a lot. Again, you can see why, too, because army life looks awful in this movie. It's not glamorized. No one seems to be having fun there. All they do is sit around and bitch about nouveau riche.
He becomes part of the family, so he joins this team of feverish grotesques.
Yeah, and they're all basically doing their best to keep her hopes up without getting them too high, because then she gets too insanely manic.
Yeah, they're all manic and orbiting around her mania, and he's just this ultra, ultra laid back guy, right? The genius of Albert Leven's performance is that he plays this, he's like playing wooden. He's playing this absolutely ordinary guy who does not believe he can ever transcend his own very visible limitations. And yet, at the same time, you can see that his very ordinariness is what makes him appeal to her.
And he just keeps telling everyone, I'm just an ordinary guy. I'm not like you. I'm not this great doctor who won't even take money.
Humanitarian?
I'm just a soldier.
I'm just an idiot.
He's clearly so much more than that.
Is he? Is it clear?
Well, I think it is. Or normalcy is much more interesting than it's cracked up to be, which maybe is part of the message of the film, too. Even a guy like this is racked with doubt and lives the examined life and frequently fails his own examinations. But yeah, a key scene, Ernest Thesiger comes up to Albert Leven and asks him to wheedle the truth out of the doctor. Will Lilli Palmer ever walk again? We got a little flashback. She's only been paralyzed, or not paralyzed, but unable to walk for 2 years, and it was a riding accident. So very much, again, like the Betty Davis character in Dark Victory, she was an unusually active young woman and physical.
But it explains some of this mania and this sexual desperation.
Right. Albert Leven accepts the challenge and rides into the train station with the doctor. They have a nice long talk that drifts into metaphysics at certain points.
Sure. What is truth?
Finally.
But then finally, Albert Leven is like, but no, really, what I wanted to ask you.
Like, what's the truth about Lilli Palmer's condition?
But then there's even more miscommunication that happens, because the doctor won't just straightforwardly tell him that there is hope or there is no hope. And he tells him this anecdote about some woman who had a similar condition who was cured.
And Switzerland. Yes, he's going to see about it. So it's true at that time that there's...
And so Albert Leven absolutely fucks up again, because when he broken telephone Lee conveys this message as the father demanded that he do.
The father is waiting for him in the rain at the station.
And they all go insane again.
You know, I don't think he did a bad job, because he did tell them, he's like, this does not mean that she's going to be well.
No, but anything he does destroys her. Anything. Any gesture he makes.
Yeah, I mean, Lilli Palmer is a hand grenade, and the pin has been pulled out before the movie started. That's her character in this movie. It's incredible.
Yeah.
What a great way for her to go out in British cinema for now. I mean, she'll be back in the 50s, but she's off to Hollywood.
The movie that was too much for anybody to take. But here, there's a movie that seems like a distant, we already mentioned in this episode, that seems like a distant relative, a cousin of sorts to this one, which is, again, Magnificent Obsession, which does have a disability romance that is miraculously cured by the end of it.
But Irene Dunn is a lot more stoic.
Well, I was thinking of Rock Hudson and Jane Wyman. Well,
Jane Wyman is also more stoic.
Jane Wyman reinvents stoicism for the 50s.
That's right. Lilli Palmer is getting into Joan Crawford in Possessed territory here.
Somewhere between that and Dark Victory. I mean, that's true, though, if you're thinking about the way she keeps throwing herself at him, because she's just endlessly humiliating herself in these insane, cringeworthy scenes.
Her big moment where she kisses him. Not going to forget this movie.
What does a child get before she goes to bed? You've forgotten.
He tries to kiss her on the forehead and her upper body is very mobile and she maneuvers into a sexual assault.
It's important that through the whole movie we just feel his repulsion. It's actually indifference, but under the circumstances it becomes repulsion because there's this pressure on him to respond. I mean, obviously there's a relationship to our favorite melodrama text to refer to, which is Henry James's The Wings of the Dove.
Once the Switzerland story has circulated within the castle, nothing's ever going to be the same again. And Lilli Palmer has now made the leap to, I am going to be cured, and now I deserve your love.
Yeah, she keeps thinking she is in a movie. She keeps thinking she's in the movie that this movie ought to be, the genre that it ought to be, right? Where she's going to be cured by love.
And she asks him if he can come along to Switzerland. Again, this is irritating because he doesn't have the option to do that.
Right, this is part of the, well, I don't know if you want to call it class or privilege or whatever, the discrepancy between them and between her and everyone else.
Right, because everyone else, or most of the other people in the film, have duties, and she does not. I mean, her only...
But that's also the Wings of the Dove. Millie Teal invites Merton Densher along to Venice, doesn't she?
She does, that's right, yeah. And again, we're kind of in Dark Victory territory a little bit, where everyone's sharing this secret that cannot be divulged to Lilli Palmer. The secret in this case is that while the doctor's already investigated the Switzerland case, it's just not an injury that has any similarity or applicability to Lilli Palmer's case, but they can't tell her that, so they have to...
Well, the doctor literally says in one of the movie's great flourishes of insanity, well, we're all gonna have to go to Switzerland now.
Yep.
We have to keep her happy, or she's just gonna die.
She's gonna kill herself.
Or she's just gonna die.
Yeah.
She's gonna die of a broken heart.
Maybe we can improvise some other way to cure her.
But that is also the Wings of the Dove. Everyone just keeps saying to Merton Densher, you just have to make her happy. She has to be happy. Yeah. Like, keep this fucking rich woman happy.
Part of making her happy, on the eve of her departure for Switzerland, Albert Leven goes to the castle once again, sits down to dinner with Lilli and her father, and Ernest Thesiger asks this young soldier to sit at the head of the table because he wants to visualize what their married life together will be like after he's gone. And I mean, he certainly looks decrepit, Ernest Thesiger. He looks like he could go at any moment.
Well, we haven't even mentioned that they got engaged.
They got engaged, yeah. And he's starting to, seems to be getting into it, right? When he goes over, he gives her an actual kiss. Like, it's a real kiss.
I can't remember how does this all come about? How does he start thinking that, how does he allow himself to get engaged to her? Because she's going to go away and find out that there's no cure. Is that what he's counting on? That when she finds out there's no cure, she won't hold him to it? I can't remember how this
all... Yeah, well, she says at some point that, you know, any promises made are rendered null and void if I can't walk. So maybe that gives him a little bit of breathing room to actually look at her as a normal woman for a change. And he seems to really be into that kiss that he gives her.
And in the power reversal that we see, you know, the power gender reversal that we keep seeing in them, she gives him a ring.
Yep.
To remember her by.
Yeah, it's not an engagement ring exactly, but it's kind of an engagement ring. After he leaves, he goes down to the barracks where all the old hens in the army are chortling about how he's gotten himself hitched or engaged to be hitched to this crippled bourgeoise, and he denies it.
Yeah, it's obviously, it appears to be modeled in the movie on the denial of Christ.
Because
Christian ethics do come up.
Yeah, I think you're right.
And the level of betrayal is similar.
In this town, because anytime anyone says anything about anyone, it gets back to the person who's going to be hurt by it the most.
And it is an honest betrayal, because we have, I don't remember exactly how it all unfolds in the plot, but by this time, we know he has feelings for her, although he doesn't think he can go through with marrying her. So this denial is real. It's a denial of something real.
Oh yeah, he's angry at himself for being in this situation at all. And he's just acting out in the presence of the worst people in the world. The whole thing was started because this mayor of the town, I think the guy playing the mayor is the same guy that was holding Rex Harrison prisoner in The Rake's Progress, but I don't know the actor's name. This has been an ongoing tug of war between these people. The mayor is insulted by the army is insulted by the mayor, and here he's been called a liar now. Albert Levin has denied the story, and this causes the mayor to go ballistic, and he makes a beeline for the castle as soon as the denial is made public, and he makes it private inside the precincts of Lilli Palmer's home, and she hears about it and is destroyed by it, as we would expect. That all unfolds in one part of the narrative. Meanwhile, Albert Levin goes to see his commanding officer, and they concoct a scheme that will get him out of it. They're just going to send him to another town. That's going to be it. Levin's just going to exit and not look back. That's what he's ordered to do. He's not even allowed to communicate with anyone. And he at first grasps at this like a lifeline, but he doesn't stick to that. He feels that he must go to see the doctor, and the doctor is out, but he finds Gladys Cooper, the doctor's wife, and they have this incredible heart-to-heart. She is blind, and they have this great romance. So if you're looking for a great and inspiring romance involving disability, well, you have it in this movie.
But he says that it's only available to a person as extraordinary as these two.
Right.
And certainly Lilli Palmer doesn't seem anywhere near as noble as Gladys Cooper.
It almost gave me a little feeling of The Enchanted Cottage, the life that the doctor and Gladys Cooper have.
Sure.
But no, Albert Levin and Lilli Palmer are not going to get to have their own enchanted cottage or enchanted castle or enchanted anything.
Even though they're both ridiculously good looking.
It's true.
But yeah, so Gladys Cooper just tells him, you do love this woman, you stupid idiot. You're not just going to the castle every day out of pity, but you are too much of a coward to realize that. And he says he doesn't see himself as being capable of having that marriage.
Gladys Cooper convinces him, no, this is not the way a normal friendship goes either. This is...
Well, they're not going to have children. It is going to be an unusual relationship if he commits himself to being with a woman who will probably never be cured of paralysis.
Yeah, it's a real challenge he has to overcome. It's a real block within his mind, but he's overcome it by the end of his conversation with Gladys Cooper. She is that persuasive and compassionate.
Nope, love is worth all of this.
It is. Now, he tries to call, but Archduke Franz Ferdinand has been assassinated, and all phone lines are being used by the military.
So this is the Romeo and Juliet ending, being provided by the most famous event in Austrian history.
Yeah.
Franz Ferdinand fucked it.
He did, and so did Gavrilo Princip, the Black Hand assassin in Sarajevo. So he can't call her, can't get the message to her. He's gonna try to do it on foot or on train, but he's got his orders, and he has no certainty that he's gonna make it there in time.
So Gladys Cooper is like, fine, I'll go. I'm so persuasive. You just saw how persuasive I am. I'll go. And movie viewers are like, oh, this is gonna be fine. It's gonna be like a close call, but she'll get the job done. She's practically a saint.
Yeah, I was convinced. I had no hint, no suspicion that it was gonna end in actual
death. Well, like I said, I read the plot summary of the actual novel, and I was still like, oh, they changed it for the movie.
Right. Yeah, well, it's the least you could have expected, but no. So that is an incredible scene as well. Lilli Palmer has been stoically going through the motions of pretending that she is going to go to Switzerland.
Well, now she paranoiaically and yet accurately believes that since his love for her has been a lie, then everyone must be lying to her about this cure as well. And she's right. And she figures this out by releasing her cousin from her servitude.
Yeah.
Well, by saying, wouldn't you like to leave now? Oh, yes, 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 I would love to leave right now. Or would you prefer to wait until after Switzerland? Oh, sure, yeah, Switzerland. And then, you know, she figures it out.
She cleverly gets rid of any other servants that are hanging out on the rooftop. There's a pigeon coop up there. They've got messenger pigeons, all kinds of activity up there, but she's all set. She's alone. We've already had Chekhov's
suicide gate.
She's gonna wheel herself over to it, and Gladys Cooper arrives. And by all logic that we've learned from Hollywood movies, at the very least, this is going to be an intervention that achieves its aim. But no, Lilli Palmer...
They go for tragedy.
She deflects. She talks to Gladys Cooper for a little bit, just teasing you with this idea that there's going to be enough time for communication, enough time for real persuasion to happen. But little by little, she's wheeling herself over to the precipice.
This is a very ableist part of the movie, because it's saying that if you have a blind woman and a paralyzed woman who's determined to commit suicide by throwing herself through a gate, the blind woman's not going to be able to stop her.
I don't think anyone could have stopped her. Unless...
Superman could not have stopped her.
No, she was ready to go at that point.
Maybe Albert Levin in person could have convinced her. But
well,
that's...
he did it once. He did it the first time she tried. But no, she goes over and She's dead.
We get the report from Gladys Cooper later that she survived that fall. That's a real will to live mixed in there with her will to die. Survived that fall long enough that she realized, like the turn of the screw at the end of the Baz Luhrmann Romeo and Juliet, she wakes up long enough to realize that she killed herself pointlessly because he actually did love her.
Quite a movie. Quite a pair of movies.
Yeah, and the lesson at the end that this poor kid hearing this story has learned is you better fucking marry that girl that you've been pitying.
To beware of pity doesn't mean don't pity anyone. It means you take pity on anyone, you better ensure that it progresses to compassion and then marriage very quickly before something terrible happens. I was really impressed, and hopefully you're once again beginning to see the wisdom of this Lilli Palmer series, Elise.
Did you know one of the big stage hits that Lilli Palmer and Rex Harrison had together was Bell Book and Candle?
Yes.
Because I was just thinking of Lilli Palmer's demoniacal quality in this movie.
Yeah, she does write about that in her autobiography. It was a long-running stage success. I love the movie, and Kim Novak is really fun in that movie, but
there couldn't be any two actresses with more different qualities than those two.
Yeah, I would really like to see the Lilli Palmer version. It's too bad they didn't film the stage play or make a television version of it or something, but we'll just have to live on the accounts of it that we get. Next week on the podcast, Hollywood Studios Year by Year, MGM 1945. This is one I've been looking forward to for a long time. It's a Vincente Minnelli double feature, The Clock and Yolanda and the Thief, two of my absolute favorite movies.
Well, I like The Clock a lot. I guess this will be my second viewing of Yolanda and the Thief.
And you're going to love it.
We'll see.
All of us will see next time.